Welcome to McGovern Institute. Last time we went there, right? So today I'm going to talk about some direction in the lab that's relatively new in the last five or six years since I moved here. We started to work on the system. And you probably all know in the last 10 years there are a large number of genes identified as risk genes or causative genes for psychiatric disorders. The conclusion now is they are although genetic play a very important role in many of the psychiatric disorders, including autism, schizophrenia, bipolar, and ADHD, but the genetic causes are very heterogeneous. So, and since these are all behavior defect, one of the ways to try to develop treatment is to try to understand what is the circuit mechanism underlying each individual behavior, then we might be able to identify a circuit that we can manipulate which can correct the behavior defect. And it is, unless the intervention is very, very early, it's unlikely that in the adult stage, in the grown-up stage, you will be able to find one target that treats all the symptoms in any of the given disorders, especially for autism spectrum disorders or neurodevelopmental disorders. They usually affect many, many different systems, and they usually have intellectual disabilities and in addition to the symptoms. So one of the circuits we are particularly interested in is the cortical striatothalamocortical circuits. This is involved, has been shown involved in many different disorders, including OCD, autism, and Tourette's, and ADHD, or even part of the, some of the symptoms from schizophrenia. So today I'm going to so the way to achieve that, we think we are trying to find common pathways used a variety of different models, and including human patients and of course different animal models. And these we are hoping that by studying the circuits will allow us to identify mechanisms across different disorders, because it's very clear that there are some symptoms that are overlapping in many of the disorders. We're also hoping that after studying so many years in mice, and including the behavior and the circuits, mouse behavior, although we all claim them, including my lab, say, oh, these are autistic-like behavior, OCD-like behavior, but they are quite different from humans. And I think future study can help us to shifting more from the behavior phenotype to neurophysiological phenotypes. And so understand circuit defect may help us to identify these neurophysiological defects that will be much more translatable from animal studies to human studies. And of course, the one of the major issues in the field is we don't really have like for cancer or for other disorders, we don't have biomarkers. We don't have a way to objectively diagnose the disease. We based on the behavior observation or talking to the parents or talking to the patient, and so. I think in the future, neurophysiological phenotype could be one of the main aspects of translatable biomarkers. That once we have the biomarker, it will be much easier to relate animal model studies to human disorders. So today I'm going to focus on one of the circuits, circuits that we have been studying in the last 6 years, and which is called thalamic reticular nucleus, which is part of the thalamus. And you all know that thalamus play a very important role in relays controlled cortical function, thalamic cortical controls. And one of the component is thalamic reticular nucleus, which is called TRN. They provide almost all the inhibitions to the thalamus that control the output of the thalamic output to the cortex. So this is TRN is a very unique structure. It's a group of GABAergic neurons. Most of them are power albumin positive neurons, and they surround the thalamus. And this is provide a key inhibition to the thalamus. And this is TRN has been studied by many neurobiologists, and that this function as a integrator of the sensory information. Basically, you can stream the information and delete the distraction information, so make the, it's really involved in the attention, emotion, and in part of cognition. And this is also, TIN has also been shown over genetic studies and other studies show that it play a very key role in the generation of sleep spindles. So disruption of TIN function may be also involved in the sleep disorders, which has been seen in many psychiatric disorders, including autism and schizophrenia. And one of the advantages for the sleep spindles, we can measure them in animals and in humans use EEGs. So this could potentially be a biomarker, translatable biomarker. And finally, TIN dysfunction has been implicated in many disorders, especially in autism and schizophrenia. Especially sleep spindle reduction has been found in both autism and in schizophrenia patients. So we try to see whether we can use this mouse model as a tool to understand how disruption of TIN function can contribute to neurodevelopmental disorders. So the gene we are, also, the other thing we found recently is that there are many genes, hundreds of genes have been identified as a candidate gene or risk genes for different schizophrenia, different psychiatric disorders, including autism and schizophrenia. And we found many of these genes, actually a significant portion of these genes are highly expressed in the TIN. This is the thalamus, this is the TIN, wrapping the thalamus. So you can see these are, the T channels and mGluR3 and CHD2 and PACHD1, these are all strong candidate genes for, this is two for actual schizophrenia, GWAS hit. These two are candidate genes for autism. So we are, this study I'm going to talk about with the focus on PACHD1, you can already see that PACHD1 is highly expressed in the striatum. So PACHD1 actually was involving neurodevelopment was originally discovered by a group, a couple groups in Canada, Guy Rury and also John Vincent in McGill and Toronto. What they found is that there is a group of patients that they found that, they have a deletion in the PACHD1 gene. And so this is an X-linked gene. So almost all the patients are male, because in male you become null. And so it has a variable phenotype. It's a non-syndromic neurodevelopmental disorder. These symptoms including sleep disorders, ADHD, hypotonia, motor problems, and very aggressive, and also an autism spectrum disorder and an intellectual disability. And this gene, actually, no one has studied before its function. So it's a 12 transmembrane protein, but with unknown function. So when we initially studied, we found that it's actually at the early developmental stage is very highly concentrated in the TIN, almost no expression, relatively no expression in other parts of brain. So we thought this would be a very good gene to look at how disruption of TIN function can contribute to what aspect of neurodevelopmental disorder, whether it's play a role in the neurodevelopmental disorder, or if so, what is the specific aspect the TIN function, TIN plays in the neurodevelopmental disorder. And later on, at the P15, these are mouse brains, at the P15, you can see still highly concentrated TIN, but it starts to express in other parts of the brain, including cortex and striatum. So we made a conditional knockout. Initially, we made a conditional knockout mouse of this because it's on X chromosome. It's actually much easier, and we use the male mice to study the many aspects of the development, the function of this gene. So the first thing we did, this was a collaboration with my Kalasa's lab. At that time he was still at MIT, now he's a faculty at NYU. So initially we looked at whether in the knockout mice is there any defect in TIN and the related function, which is a sleep spindle. And we found that indeed using in vivo recordings show that the TIN bursting finding is significantly reduced, and that sleep spindle, number of sleep spindle is also also reduced. And if we disrupt the sleep spindles, there's a possibility that it may disrupt the sleep. And so when we look at the sleep, actually the total time is very similar. However, duration of sleep bouts. Every time they fall asleep, and the sleep length much shorter. So that means they wake up much more often. So they are, so we call it disrupted sleep. And you can see that. So the medium bout, every time they sleep, the time is much shorter. So suggesting that although they sleep, total time is very similar, but they wake up more often, which is probably the quality of sleep is reduced. Suggesting that maybe this the disruption of tRNA function can contribute to this sleep disruptions, and then the of course as I mentioned the key thing is the tRNA provide a major inhibition to thalamus. So is there a disruption to the thalamus inhibition? So can we directly measure the inhibition in the thalamus through because it's a sensory integrator? So if you provide a sensory input, it's supposed to the tRNA is supposed to send the inhibition to the thalamus to fill out the unwanted sensory information. So we use this superchromolin developed by George my colleague and friend George Augustine at Duke University. Improved by a new version called superchromolin, which you use a FRET-based assay to look at chloride concentration. And by viral injection into the LGN, which is part of thalamus, then give the light stimulation to see whether there is indeed reduced inhibition and in these mice with sensory evoked inhibition in the thalamus, because this, most of these inhibition are coming from the TRN. So indeed, if we look at it, whether it's a single pulse lighting stimulation or train of like stimulation, we can see a very significant reduction of the inhibition in the thalamus, suggesting that indeed in these mice, by disrupting the patch D1, we assume, we don't have specific at that time, but assume that that's because of the disruption of function of TRN neurons will lead to the reduction of the thalamic inhibition. So then the question is, you know, what causes the TRN, the sleep spindle defect? So previously, lots of studies have been shown that sleep, you know, the TRN bursting is controlled by two major channels. One is the T channel, calcium channel, CAV 3.3, and also calcium activated small K potassium channel, small current potassium channel, which is SK2. And they previously have shown that if you knock out whether it's CAV 3.3 or SK2, you all have reduced the sleep spindles. So there's a possibility that this channel, although we don't know the function, knocking out the channel in the TRN neuron may lead to the dysfunction of either channels or both channels. So we use the slice physiology to look at whether there is a, first of all, whether there is a, in the slice you have a defect, we have a defect in the bursting of these neurons, and then what is the channel dysfunction in this. So if you can see, this is the wild-type knockout, this is the membrane potentials, and this is the number of rebound bursting. You can see in the knockout that you have reduced the bursting. And we individually look at whether the defect is in the calcium channel or in the potassium channel. It turned out that calcium channel actually current are normal. There's no obvious defect. However, the major defect is the SK2 channel current in these mice, suggesting that the knockout of the patch D1 gene actually specifically affect the SK current. But so you can see this is just showing that the relative, you know, between the T current and SK current, you can see very significant reduction in the knockout. So the because the calcium the SK channel is calcium activated potassium channel, so we and the T channel itself is not defective, so we want to see whether there is a calcium homeostasis defect that lead to a reduced calcium for some reason and lead to the you know less activated potassium channel. So we did the calcium imaging in slice in neurons and to use calcium dye, ratio matched calcium dye to see whether there is a calcium defect. Indeed, the calcium concentration is significantly reduced in the knockout mice. So we think this might be the reason why the calcium active potassium channel is less active in these neurons. Now, it's a 12 trend membrane domain, and no one, we have no idea why knockout the this patch D1 in in these TRN neurons will lead to the defect in the calcium homeostasis. What other people have found that these are a large group of channels similar but not identical with patch D1. They're all 12 transmembrane domains, and one of them called MPC1, which is a very similar structure, but sequence is very different. And some of the studies show that the MPC1 may affect the transporting of cholesterol that lead to eventually affect the calcium homeostasis release and homeostasis of the cells. So this is possible that this gene may also affect the homeostasis through the ER function or some other functions. We try to figure out and use a variety of different ways to try to figure out how this patch D1 actually, what are the interactions with patch D1, how they may affect signaling transduction in cells. Right now, we can only tell that there is a calcium homeostasis defect, but we don't know what is the mechanism underlying this. And so since the TRN, one of the major functions of TRN is fill out the distraction so the animals can be more focused and pay attention. With Mike Halassa's lab, we did the attention test. They actually developed a very unique method that to look at the mouse attention test. They provide they showed that this assay with optogenetic studies shows very much dependent TRN and function. They published about 2 years ago in a very nice study. So we use this assay that basically you provide the mice with a signal and train them to going to get a reward if they pick the right signal, right? But after you train them, you basically, before the real signal come out, they have to choose the right side, the correct signal, and you give them, before that, you give them a distract signal. And so normal mice actually can do very well. And so in the baseline, without the noise, they can do very well. The error rate is less than 30%. And the wild-type knockouts do very similar. But in the presence of distractor, wild-type mice still do very well, but the knockout mice actually do much better, did much worse, suggesting that these mice are easily distracted, which is fit the idea that TRN function is critical for fill out the unwanted noises and make mice be able to actually pay more attention to for this attention test. And so besides to this attention defect, these mice also have many other problems. And as I mentioned earlier on, in human patients, we see a variety of different defects in the human patient. So one of the most obvious for these mice, actually, they are very hyperactive. And you put it in an open field, they move a lot. So you can see this is, and ADHD is also one of the major symptoms actually in this patient. So you can see this in open field, the mice are, whole times, 1 hour, they move a lot more. Now, one of the major drug to treat for ADHD effective in about 70% of, or 65 to 70% of patients are amphetamines. These are psychostimulants. A psychostimulant can, make it more normal people go more active, but for they are, can calm these ADHD patients down. However, these behavior in this patch D1 mice actually is not, these mice are not responsible to amphetamine, suggesting there might be a different mechanism cause this hyperactivity in this. So you put hyperactivity and attention together, these mice basically, we think, have attention deficit and hyperactivity-like behavior in these mice. So it could be a model for study the TRN-based or TRN mechanism-based ADHD-like behavior. So, and these mice also have many other problems, and you can see they have the patient have an intellectual disability. Of course, it's very difficult to test mice, but we use fear conditioning and inhibitory avoidance test to show these mice actually have a learning memory, a fear learning and a memory defect. And they also human patients are very aggressive, and these mice are super aggressive. And every time you handle them, you have to wear gloves. They want to bite you and jump out, and so they are very aggressive. And you can see the attacking time is, and duration is much longer, and latency is much shorter in this animal. And they also have motor problems, they have gait problems. These are all relevant to the motor defects that have been seen in patients. So there are so many different aspects of behavior defect that we want to see which aspect actually is directly related to TIN dysfunction, because this is a knockout in the whole mouse. And there are also things that we were looking for, but it was not defective, because we are very interested in autism. This is about 40% of the patients are diagnosed with autism spectrum disorder, but they don't have any social behavior problems. You put them together, they look pretty normal, and they don't have repetitive grooming or other things we can find. So for study social behavior deficits, this may not be a model, and we don't know why. Maybe the genes functions are not highly conserved. Maybe the social behavior in mice are very different from humans. These are all possibilities, but we haven't figured out why there are no social deficit in these animals. So our really goal is to try to figure out which aspect of this defect is related to the TIN dysfunction. So currently there is no TIN specific CRE, so they make it very difficult. Also, it's very difficult to use virus because TIN is like a shell, like a hat on the top. So it's very difficult to, it's not like a round nucleus, it's easy to inject. So it's very difficult without to knock out the whole TIN without affecting other brain area. So we use the first thing we needed to do actually is to see where else this patch D1 is expressed, so we can find a CRE that use an intersection approach to find a CRE. So we actually, my student Mike Wilson was very brave, made another mouse because we couldn't find any antibody actually working against this. We tried like 20 some antibodies. So he decided to make a knocking with GLP to label these neurons so we would know which neurons are labeled. And there were a few studies suggesting that based on the in situ and the GLP mice study, these all, although the TIN neurons are inhibitory, all other expression seems like in excited neurons. So if we can find inhibitory neuron specific CRE, then it will only knock out in the TIN without affect the other, because the other parts of brain is not overlapping. So this is, we tried PV and the somatostatin CRE. This is somatostatin expression. You can see in the TIN they're overlapping, but the other parts in the cortex, this is inhibitory neuron, this is more likely excited neuron. To confirm this, we generated a YFP mouse tagged to the protein, but knocked into the locus. So you can see that from many different areas, in TIN they match really well, but outside TIN they are very little overlapping, suggesting that use this strategy allow us to specifically knock out the patch D1 in the TIN. We are hoping to generate a TIN specific CRE for the future, which is one of the projects going on in the lab. So with this method, you can see this is in situ hybridization because we don't have antibody. And by cross the patch D1 conditional knockout with somatostatin CRE, and you can see that TIN is patch D1 expression in the TIN is eliminated, but all other areas are not affected. So they allow us to study this mouse as a model to the TIN specific knockout model. And in this model we found a few things are similar phenotypes. With the attention deficit, you can see with the distractor, and these mice make many more errors, and we still have the hyperactivity, but we don't have the learning defect, we don't have the aggression, we don't have the motor problems actually. So suggesting the attention deficit and hyperactivity is specifically linked to TIN dysfunction. So finally, we want to see whether our electrophysiological study or calcium imaging study suggesting that the defect is in the SK2 channel. So if that's the case, then if we can correct the SK2 channel function, we might be able actually to correct the problem. So luckily, there is a compound called EBIO, and this compound is very, if you use high doses, it's actually toxic. So it's unlikely it can be used in humans, but it can only be used in mice as a low dose and as a short term, as a proof of principle. Whether if we correct the SK2 channel defect can we rescue the problem, and what problem can we rescue? So this is actually is the activator of the can enhance the SK channel function. And so we use systemic application of this, and when we inject these drugs to these patch doing knockout mice, and if we measure the inhibition, you can see the thalamic inhibition in LGN is restored, suggesting that indeed can restore the function of the TIM. And if we look at the hyperactivity, you can see these are knockout mice. You can see much more high active compared to the wild type of black. But when after we injected the drug, you can see the activity. You can calm down these mice to the normal level or wild type level, suggesting that indeed if we enhance SK2 channel activity, we can actually correct the hyperactivity effect. We can also correct the attention deficit. You can see this is the without the drug vehicles. This is the drug. You can see the error rate are significantly reduced, suggesting indeed that the SK channel dysfunction is the cause of these two major symptom phenotypes in these mice. However, with this drug, actually we cannot correct the learning defect use the fear fear conditioning paradigms. So they're suggesting they are cell type specific and circuit specific defects that can be corrected by SK2 channel. Although SK2 channel expressed in many other places, and you probably also corrected the defect in other areas, but you cannot actually correct the phenotypes unrelated to TIN. And so I'm going to summarize this. So in this study, we show that patch doing expression is restricted TIN at P0, and patch doing deletion attenuate TIN neuronal bursting activity by reduced SK2 potassium channels. And this potassium channel defect can lead us to find a new target, because as you all know, potassium channels are all over the body. They affect, play a very important role in many basic functions, and including heart and other parts. So it's probably not a very good druggable target, but it is possible now for us to know, it is for us now, it's known that modulated TIN function may be a target that can be used to treat ADHD-like behaviors. And so now in the lab, we are doing large-scale single RNA-seq in collaboration with Aviv's lab, do large-scale single-cell RNA of TIN neuron to try to identify what are the channels and the target that could potentially be useful as a target to develop new strategies for treatment by specifically modulating TIN function. And we also show deletion of the PhD in TIN lead to attention deficit and hyperactivity. And whether this can be used, the TIN or part of thalamus circuits can be used as a target in the future to enhance attention, right? You all have jet lags, you come here, you cannot pay attention to my talk. But if we have something can enhance, I would love to use. I know Bob used something. I'm not sure it's legal or not, but you use. And so this is, could be a potentially a future target to modulate the circuit function to increase attention. If I go to, I go to China very often, and I really hard to pay attention to these conferences. Maybe I'll pop in a pill, I'll give a drink, and then I can really pay attention for the next 8 hours. So we're trying to identify the target, whether we can use that circuit to increase attention. And so one of the things we showed is both attention deficit and hyperactivity can be rescued by pharmacologic augment of SK channels. But I don't think it's the channel itself, it's more of the TIN cellular function. And we also showed that this will not, this cannot correct other problems. So what we are also interested in this patchy mutant might show many behavior abnormalities which are relevant to the patient, which is very surprising to me actually, including associated learning, hyperaggression, and motor defects. And now we have people in the lab are very interested in trying to figure out what is the circuits of aggression, because aggression actually is a symptom often seen in many different psychiatric disorders, right? Including autism, schizophrenia, which is very hard to control. So in all, we think there are cell type specific and circuit specific function and dysfunction. So each individual phenotype, you may need dissecting individually and pinpointed to a circuit, then we can try to develop a different target. If you think about SK2 channel and dysfunction, if that is the main defect in the TIN, correct that problem only going to solve the problem related to TIN. It's not going to solve all other problems related to this gene mutation. That's why at the beginning I said it's very unlikely, unless you treat them very, very early to find the initial defect, that in the patient you will be able to find a drug target that can suddenly cure or treat all the symptoms you find in ASD. So that's kind of our strategy, to dissect individual problems, symptoms, or phenotypes that understand circuits and that allow us to really modulate the particular circuits and relate it to that behavior abnormality. So at the end, I want to acknowledge people who did the work. This work was mainly done by a collaboration in Mike Lassa's lab. The main person is a former graduate student, Mike Wells, who now is a postdoc in Kevin Agnew's lab at Harvard now, and with postdoc fellow Ralph Wimmer from Mike Lassa's lab, also with some help with Ian Schmidt, and also Simons Foundation, Stanley Center, and the Poitras Center at the McGovern Institute, also NIMH, supported my work. Thank you. Great.